Songs and Sit Downs, featuring Owen Guerra. And now, Owen Guerra.
Good evening, and welcome to Songs and Sit Downs. This, our 10th show in the series. Wow, we're up to double digits already. Thank you so much for joining us. We hope you had a great long weekend. I hope you had a nice, relaxing 4th of July. Of course, there wasn't a whole lot to do, as this year there was pretty much no gatherings, no fireworks, at least not any legal fireworks. But a great many people, all of whom seem to be living in my neighborhood here in North Pasadena, decided to take it upon themselves to get their own fireworks and proceed to mark this particular Independence Day by independently showing how proud and how seriously friggin' loud they could be. I mean, I couldn't believe how many were going off all around me all through the night. I mean, I actually managed to get to bed about midnight, fell asleep soon after that, and then one went off. Soon as I got to sleep, one just went off. I was awoken by a thunderous succession of fireworks just down the street. You know, I was trying to be a good sport about it. I was like, yay, independence. And then, of course, I went straight back to sleep. No problem. But then 10 minutes later, it happens again. And I woke up and I was like, yay, independence. Went back to sleep for about 5 minutes. Woke up again. Yay, independence. And then it kept happening just over and over for hours and hours and hours. By 4 a.m., I was like, okay, that's it. For God's sake, somebody bring back the British. I didn't really mean that, because if anybody's watching and they heard me say that, they could really, because where I come from, you know, that could really be used against me. But for a moment, I was like, you know what? Forget this whole freedom and independence thing. The only time we're free, really, truly, is when we're sleeping. So, anyway, it was a lot of trouble. It was an interesting night, and I'm kind of sleep-deprived. But looking forward to this, managed to get some sleep last night, but still the fireworks are going off. And we may be interrupted by some other fireworks that are going to, in fact, I bet actually, because it's going to get dark really soon, and there'll be some fireworks, and so you'll probably hear what I'm talking about. It seems to just go on for days and days and days. And speaking of going on, we're going to go on over to Van Nuys right now, and we're going to say hello to our fearless leaders over there at Divine Rebel Music headquarters, and see how they're doing, see if they managed to get some sleep during this very loud celebration of Independence Day. And hi, guys.
Hi.
Hey, Owen.
How are you?
Good.
Good.
We had about the same experience.
Did you really?
Yeah. But I'm pretty sure it's everywhere.
Yeah, because I thought they must have all just come over here. But no, they were over there as well.
I appreciated them. Truly, I appreciated it much more when I was a kid.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
But yeah, so, but... You know, our puppy, she's actually really good with the fireworks. We were so happy about
good.
That. Yeah.
Good. Because that's the worst.
I know a lot of people had some really bad experiences with their fur babies.
Yes.
So, yeah.
Well, that's good to hear. Now, do we have any announcements regarding subscribing to our YouTube channels?
Yes. I actually put the link in the post I shared to get people to watch the show. Mm-hmm. People, if you would kindly subscribe to our YouTube channels, both Owen and Divine Rebel Music. It would be Owen Guerra and Divine Rebel Music. I will put the links in the comments to make it as easy as possible for you. And in doing so, it would help us monetize on this show that we absolutely love doing. That we, you know, yes, the goal is to help us monetize on this show.
Which means we got to get to 1,000 each. So
yes.
If we do that, we can stream on our YouTube channels and we can put ads. And so then we don't have to ask our viewers to donate if they're in a position
That's
to
right.
do so. So speaking
That's
of which,
right.
we might as well talk about the tips. We're on the subject. So if you do feel like donating something tonight, we do share with our musical artists. and anything you can afford. And there's the tip jar, the legendary tip jar, which
yes.
is now full of money, but it's somewhat virtual, I'm afraid. But as we always say, we're so happy to have you guys here.
Always.
And thank you for tuning in.
Yes.
And if you can subscribe to our YouTube channels, that would be fantastic. And if you can't, just throw us $1,000. I'm just kidding.
We'd appreciate it, though, if you did.
I'm just kidding. Make it 500.
But I will put both links, the tip jar links and the YouTube links, in our comments to make it, again, as easy as possible for you. And thank you for watching, because we do work really hard on the show, you know, to provide an entertaining hour plus for you every week. And we would greatly appreciate it.
Great.
That's
well, thank you guys so much. We'll talk to you a little bit later in the show.
Okay. See ya.
Thank you. So I just realized, I say that every week. I'm like, hey, we'll talk to you later in the show. And we just never, it's like, you know, when you ghost somebody. But we do get to chat after the show, but we don't, we spare our audience by not putting our conversation on the broadcast. So anyway, upcoming shows, we do that every week. We talk about all the gigs that are going around in LA, because we're basically a music-based program. We do other things too, but music is really how all this started. And let's see what's going on around, here are all the gigs that are happening live around Los Angeles. And if you've tuned in before, you know we do that joke every week. Now it's just become a joke that we do the joke. The joke is there's nothing going on, which is not really a joke. But fortunately, we have the technology that there are some live streams happening. And later on, we'll let you know what live streams are going on over the next couple of weeks. So there's plenty to tune in for. And as I said, we're very happy that you're here tonight. And you're going to be happy that you're here, because we have some great guests for you tonight. In just a little while, I'm going to be speaking with Josefina Lopez. She's a renowned playwright, novelist, and an award-winning screenwriter. She's a trailblazer in the Latin community and beyond. She's a great writer who's always honest in her opinions. She's been blessed with great talent and great wisdom. So I'm really looking forward to chatting with her. And of course, we're delighted that she's agreed to share this time with us all. And after that, we're going to have Paul Zolo, who happens to be our first ever repeat musical guest on the show. He joined us almost a couple of months ago now, here on Songs and Sit-Downs, and he was so well received that by popular demand, we just had to have him back. If you happen to catch that particular show, you might remember some of the audience comments that actually said, "More Zolo, we want more Zolo." And I'm literally quoting some of those comments that came in, and so did we. So we're extremely grateful he agreed to join us tonight to share some more of his songs and his many varied and colorful experiences. It's just going to be great. So stay with us. But first, we're going to go to a segment that we all know and love, and it's created and presented by a very, very wonderful, positive and uplifting human being. It's a segment that I always look forward to, as I'm sure you do too. This is On the Upside with Jessica Lancaster.
Hey guys, happy Monday. I hope you had a fabulous 4th of July. And hey, let's get to it. Some good news for you. There is a team of UCLA scientists that they announced have developed a glove that translates American Sign Language into speech in real time. The UCLA team said the glove contains sensors in the little digits to identify each word, phrase, or letter in American Sign Language and transmits them wirelessly to a smartphone app that translates them at a rate of one word per second.
I. Now. Why. I love you.
This is amazing, and I will for sure get this app. Do you ever wonder what space smells like? Like outer space? Well, now you can. Decades ago, NASA designed a fragrance to train astronauts on how outer space actually smells. Now they are releasing it to the world. The resulting perfume is called Oh, This Space, or Eh, This Space. Now us lowly earthlings will be able to smell like they've just taken a walk through the Milky Way. Astronauts describe the smell as a mix of gunpowder, steak, raspberries, and rum. Well, as a pacifist vegetarian, I'm not sure about the gunpowder and steak smell, but, you know, sign me up for the raspberry and rum. You know what? I don't know. Maybe I will stick with my Chanel number 5. When New York City teacher Dawn Thompson missed her pre-K students because of social distancing, instead of sending them an email or a text message, she sang it. She traveled to each of her 21 students' homes, giving them a personal concert by singing Ain't No Mountain High Enough.
Ain't no mountain high enough.
She is awesome, and can we say teacher of the year? You know, the world could use a smile right now, and Milo, the denture-stealing Jack Russell poodle mix, is here for you. The puppy stole false teeth from his owner's mother in Wales, and he supplied plenty of laughs for his human, Stacey Owen. She said that Milo has learned to open drawers and emerge with this smile-inducing treasure. Thank you, Milo, for the laugh. Okay, guys, that's it for me. Thank you so much for tuning in. And if you have any good news at all that you want to share, please send it our way so we can share the love. All right, guys, bye.
Thank you, Jessica Lancaster. Always uplifting, always great stories. And I love that one with the dog and the teeth and all of the others. So wonderful. Thank you for bringing us that segment every week. We always very much appreciate it. Now, going to move on. Our next guest, first special guest of the evening, Josefina Lopez, was born in Mexico and emigrated to the United States with her family at age of 5. She is a celebrated playwright, author, and screenwriter, having started her career at the tender age of 19 when she wrote the play Real Women Have Curves, which subsequently became a movie starring America Ferrera. The film, for which she co-wrote the screenplay, received much acclaim, including being awarded the coveted Audience Award at the Sundance Film Festival. She has a BA in film and screenwriting from Columbia College Chicago and an MFA in screenwriting from the UCLA School of Theater, Film, and Television. And on top of all that, she also graduated with a Supreme Diploma from Le Cordon Bleu. So if she invites you for dinner at her place, don't miss that opportunity. She's the recipient of numerous awards, including a formal recognition by Barbara Boxer's Women Making History Banquet. She's received a screenwriting fellowship from the California Arts Council, and she's won the Humanitas Prize for Screenwriting. Pretty impressive, I must say. Before we meet Josefina, let's take a look at a clip from the highly acclaimed and popular film based on her original play. This is a preview for Real Women Have Curves.
Turn the lights on. I want you to see me. See, this is what I look like.
Qué bonita.
Tomorrow you come to work with us in the factory.
What?
If we don't help your sister, who else is going?
What do you mean not going to college?
Anna has an appetite for life.
Are you going to be working here full time?
Just until I find a better job.
Oh, me too. I'm just working here until I win the lottery.
For love.
A nice night tonight.
I guess this is good night.
For ideas.
A man wants a virgin.
You're so old-fashioned.
A woman has thoughts, a mind of her own.
A mind? Thoughts?
But not everyone appreciates where it's taking her.
Anna is going to go to college, but not now.
We are a family, and we intend to stay that way.
This is a sweatshop.
I'm grateful for what Ama has taught me, and I'm proud of what I do. Cosa.
Jimmy, does your mom understand you?
You'll never fit into them. It's a size 7.
It's like she hates me. She thinks I'm fat, and I'm ugly, and God.
Hey, you're not fat. You're beautiful.
You lost your virginity, didn't you?
I'm your imagining things.
I can tell. ¿Por qué no te diste tu valor?
You would say that, wouldn't you?
I'm not your baby anymore.
What is wrong with your sister?
Si te quieres ir, lárgate.
Girls nowadays think they know so much.
It's so hot in here.
Look at you. The two of you should lose weight.
This is who we are, Mama.
I look like a cow.
Mostly shut up.
Look at my hips.
You want to see cellulite? Here we go.
Excuse me, ladies. You want stretch marks? Estela!
Ladies!
Oh, look! How beautiful we are!
Who cares what we look like?
Let it all hang out!
You could be beautiful!
Stop it! You're overweight, too! So why should I listen to you?
Real women have curves.
Anna, don't eat the flan.
Wow, I love that movie too. I see some comments coming up about how much people love that movie. And so excited to introduce to you Josefina Lopez.
Josefina Lopez. It's Josefina. Sorry, I know. Everyone has always mispronounced my name growing up. So I go, Jose. Anyway.
Josefina Lopez.
Yeah, it's just, it's a weird, tricky name. I believe me, at Starbucks, I go, Josie. Just call me Josie.
Okay. So from here on in, Josefina Lopez, I shall call you.
Josefina. Yeah, it's Josefina. Almost like, you don't have to, but it's just Josefina.
Josefina. Wow, I'm getting my first Spanish lesson from Josefina Lopez. This is very good.
Right.
I appreciate that. Well, it's so good to see you. How are you doing?
I'm doing terrific. I'm one of those people that thrives in chaos. Yeah. You know, I'm an immigrant. So for me, like, I don't get scared. I get busy. I hustle. I'm like, all right. You know, so I've been very productive. I have to say I've never been afraid of dying. So I live myself fully. And then I have ADD. So I can't just, like, you know, sit still and feel sorry for myself or anything like that.
Well, I guess my next question has to be, how do you write a novel, not to mind a screenplay and all the plays you've written, but how do you write a novel with ADD?
That was hard. You know, I waited till the very end, just like a typical ADD person. I had a whole year to write it. And I was like, a month before it was due, I was like, oh my God. And I got it done.
Wow.
And so then, of course, you know, everything gets rewritten. So thank God.
So you were under contract to write that book. So you actually had a deadline.
I did. Yeah. So I work by deadline. I can get a lot of stuff done, but I need a hard deadline. And then the adrenaline kicks in my brain and then I get it done.
Yeah. So you need to be under pressure. Now, you wrote Real Women Have Curves, the play, at 19. How?
I started writing it at 19 and then I did several rewrites. And then at 21, it was well enough to be presented at a theater. Yeah. And it's celebrating a 30-year anniversary. Actually, in May, it was 30 years since it got presented at a theater. Yeah.
Wow, that's amazing. And it actually was in different theaters around the country, wasn't it?
It's had over 100 productions.
Wow.
And right before COVID, we were supposed to have the 30-year anniversary in San Francisco, and I was directing it, and we had to shut it down. Yeah. Wow.
Well, yep. Sorry to hear that. And then your other play, Detained in the Desert, that also got made into a movie.
Well, I produced it. I made it into a movie, yeah. Uh-huh. And then I've written over 20 plays and 20 screenplays, but those are my most well-known. I also wrote a play when I was 17 called Simply Maria and the American Dream, which became a PBS special when I was 18. So I actually started my career officially at 18, and I won an Emmy and, you know, a bunch of awards. So But Real Women is my first full-length play that I started at 19, yeah. Yeah, but I feel like it was given to me because, you know, I was talking about intersectional feminism before it was cool to talk about race, class, and gender. Mm-hmm. And I've been talking about all the subjects that we're finally talking about, like, 30 years ago. I've been writing movies, all these subjects, but, you know, as Latinos, Hollywood just ignores us. And so, luckily, we're finally having these conversations about race that people refuse to have for so long, you know?
Mm-hmm. Well, I've heard you say that Hollywood is a business, it's commercial. So, like, if you want to bring your expression and your art in there, you've got to fit in with what's going on there in general. Now, it seems to me that some of your work is something that kind of passed those gatekeepers, even though you weren't sticking to what's normally trendy.
Well,
you know?
It really took a female executive at HBO to say yes.
Wow.
It takes women who have the power to say yes, because a lot of my work has been championed by women. And oftentimes people who are not Latinos who are in a position of power to say this story is important because stories about mothers and daughters and the value of women is important. It's universal. And that's how come I think it got made, because I was like, I never thought it was going to get made. And so when it did, I said, well, it must be some angel pulling strings as well. But it really took a woman who had the power to say yes for it to get made.
And I think it touched a lot of people. I mean, our own Dolly Ramirez of Divine Rebel Music said that she was very moved by that movie when she saw it. It really spoke to her. And I'm sure that's the same for a lot of women. Was it in any way based on your own life at that time?
It was. So, you know, when you have ADD, your hormones are off. So I've always struggled with my weight. And so to me, I always felt that it was horrible that only thin women get listened to. That if you're a big woman, if you're huge, that you're invisible. And I saw that you could be a big woman and nobody sees you. You're the invisible woman who's, you're not, nobody hears you. So the theory of like, oh my God, you know, like, and I read this book called Fat is a Feminist Issue that talked about how so many women are overweight because their weight says the FU to society. Because society doesn't allow women to own their anger because we're called bitches if we get angry at the injustice of being marginalized and exploited and abused and raped, you know, it's like. We're not allowed to be angry about the fact that it sucks being a woman on planet Earth right now.
Well, what's great is you have no qualms about expressing your opinions, and you know.
I had to fight. I mean, I tell people I've lost a lot of jobs because of this tongue and this mouth, but you know what? I came here to speak the truth, not to be pretty. You know.
Yeah, well, it comes through in your work. I mean, I've read your book too, Hungry Woman in Paris, and there are some things that you get into there that are just, I mean, you get graphic and you get real, and it's just like, wow, you just take me into that world, and it's incredible.
Because I think it sucks that women have to apologize for being sexual beings.
Yes.
You know, I've gotten a lot of male fans as a result of that book because I go, you know, all women have sex and get blowjobs, and yet we can't talk about it. We can't write about it. We can't talk frankly about the hunger. Like, men can have sexual hunger and no apologies, no need to explain. But a woman has to fall in love or pretend she's in love to get laid. And I feel like women have the right to be hungry. And we're so hungry for spirituality, for our self-worth. And I just wanted to honor all of our hungers as a right, as a human being, you know, and that's why I wrote that book. And also to deal with my depression.
Right. Well, of course, it's conditioning that kind of sends us that way. But the interesting, and I want to talk a little moment about the depression in a little moment, but something about that book, too. You had so many themes in it. I mean, the underlying family of what your family expected. And then, you know, I assume that the part in Paris, at least, was basically written as a result of your being there studying cooking.
I did. I went to cooking school so I could write this novel.
Wow.
It's a very erotic novel. And, you know, people have told me, oh, you should have taken out the sex and it would have been more commercial. It's kind of like my Eat, Pray, Love. I said, yeah, but I took away all the romance. I didn't want it to be a girl goes to Paris to fall in love. I want it to be like a woman goes to Paris to find herself and discovers that love isn't going to save her. That only self-love is going to save her, and also to get real with the fact that she was struggling with depression.
Right, and then when she gets home, there's an acceptance of what she's done in Paris when she cooks for her family, etc. And it's just
which I've never done.
I was going to ask you that.
People go, "Oh my God, you must be an amazing chef." I go, "I am. I've been to actually 4 cooking schools.
Yeah,
but I don't cook for people. It's very rare. I mean, you have to be really special, like." Maybe if I'm courting a man and dating, then maybe I would do it. But I rarely cook because I'm so busy doing so many things.
Yeah, good for you. Good for you to have all those skills and never share it with anyone.
I will eventually. I think from my kid's wedding, probably.
Oh, good, good. Well, you know, it's interesting because just to go back to when you mentioned depression and helping your art and writing and all that, helping you getting through that depression, do you find that when you're in a place like that, that it drives you to write more?
You know, I have to write because I have to keep my mind busy. So I can write anywhere. You know, I write in a bus. I can write anywhere. So to me, it's obviously, you know, when you're in a beautiful environment, it does definitely inspire me. Like I'm working on a novel about Napa Valley and all the Mexican migrants who are farm workers who are now vintners. And I go, God, I want to go live in Napa so I can finish this novel. So, yes, I think, you know, but I can write it anywhere. I survive anything.
And that's a novel you're writing right now?
Yes. It's called Blood of the Earth. And it's almost like a continuation of it's not connected at all to Hungry Woman in Paris. But I write stories about sensuality and these beautiful things that a lot of Latino immigrants don't get to experience because we're always on survival. But I want to explore things because we contribute so much to the economy of California and in so many ways that we're not given credit. So I always try to go to places that most Latino immigrants and people who are working class don't get to go, like cooking school in Paris and like Napa Valley and you know, places like that.
Yeah, it's interesting you say that because you grew up in Boyle Heights and didn't you have like seven siblings or something?
I am one of seven in a two-bedroom house with one bathroom.
Yeah. Wow.
So to me, when people talk about how hard life, I go, you know what? We had so many cockroaches that, you know, I tell people that as long that the cockroach, we had to deal with the cockroaches that we didn't kill them and they wouldn't call ice on us, you know? it was 10 of us in a two-bedroom, you know, in one bathroom. Wow. So to me, I have so much tolerance for people. Boundaries is a luxury when you're that poor. But to me, that's the time I'm so tolerant and so open-minded and that I'm like, very few things bother me.
Right. And I wonder if this bothers you because Boyle Heights, where you grew up, it's been changing over these past years. And of course, there was a movement some years ago to stop all that happening. And then it kind of seems to have fallen off our radar. There's so much else going on in the world.
It's a very complicated issue because activists like me and a lot of activists and people in the community we wanted to improve the community without gentrifying it. And the difference is that it's centered around creating improvement for the people that live there, not for the people that are going to come there. And unfortunately, when you create like a cultural center or a really cool cafe, all the developers go, oh, wow, opportunity. And then they exploit that. And then, unfortunately, we had a councilman who was unfortunately a friend of mine who we found out that he was basically selling Boyle Heights to the highest bidder. And the development escalated as a result of that. So it's really devastating that, especially when we believe that he really cared about the community and about artists and that it's actually the FBI found out differently, you know? So.
Wow. Yeah. that's sad to hear because your theater, at least your original theater, Casa 0101, am I saying that right?
0101.
Thank you. 0101. My second Spanish lesson from Josefina Lopez.
Well, 0101 is Spanish. Yeah, pero Casa. Yeah, it's Casa.
Casa. Oh, casa. I love it. I need to learn Spanish. It's such a central language.
I know. Casa.
So I actually attended a play at the original one. I know you guys moved to another place, but you were in a smaller space originally some years ago. And that was right in the center of Boyle Heights, if I remember.
Well, it was close to Mariachi Plaza, which has become kind of like the Mecca, what people think of when they think of Boyle Heights. And we were just a few blocks away, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and then you moved to a bigger space, and now you're still artistic director of that?
I'm the founding artistic director.
Yeah.
But I still am.
Yeah, well, wonderful. You don't have to get into the complicated. I sense there's more to this.
There is. But I still am the founding artistic director. And but, you know, I find that I'm an instigator. I'm a catalyst. I inspire and I basically am the leader until the real leader shows up. I'm the kind of person that can connect all the dots. I have a really fast mind. So I know that I don't necessarily need to be the leader. I just need to be the person that goes, here it is. And then the real leader shows up and then they take over. And then I say, I gotta go create more opportunities for others. And so that's what I do. I constantly create opportunities. Like I start production companies, museums. Mm-hmm. And so I'm an instigator, I'm a catalyst. And I'm not the kind of person that sticks around for a long time because when enough leaders have emerged, you let them do what they're already inspired to do.
Wow. So you see yourself with that. And earlier you mentioned about channeling and spirituality. You're on a quest right now. Would I call it that?
It's more like I'm honoring my calling and my spiritual path. Mm-hmm. When I was growing up, I didn't realize I'm an empath. And now that's like everyone's using that word now. But, you know,
I know.
As a kid, and it's cool. And I think there's a lot of us, you know. Mm-hmm. But I really could feel people's feelings. I knew what they were thinking. And I had this sixth sense that my mother has. And then it turns out on my mother's side, a lot of people have. And then I found out years later, because I thought I was going crazy, because I thought I could hear voices, I could see things, know things, feel things, predict things. Mm-hmm. And I just thought, no, I'm going to end up crazy. And so I was very afraid. that I was going to end up going crazy. And then, of course, I find out that my great-grandmother's aunt, her sister, my great-aunt, was a healer, a shaman, a curandera. And I went, oh, my God, this makes sense. Why all these things are happening to me? Why am I? And so now I go, oh. And then something within me said, at 50, your contract starts. And I was like, I have a contract? And wow. I said, that's right. At 50, because usually a woman becomes an elder, especially in the Mexican community. Mm-hmm. And after, you know, she's going to menopause. Mm-hmm. That's when she goes into her own. And for me, I basically, my psychic abilities have increased. I've gotten incredible knowing. And then I found out that I have certain abilities that have come from many past lives that I guess I've nurtured for so many that I'm an expert in certain things that usually scare the hell out of people that actually mm-hmm. really are my passion. And right. I say, oh, God, I have to honor this. Yeah, so I've become a... I'm aspiring to be an expert in the paranormal and also what people would call an exorcist. But I'm actually like a healer who basically I basically have created my own method of depossessing people without drama. So it's deliverance without drama is what I call it.
Wow. So you're not going to make a movie about it because it's not The Exorcist. But do you conflate depression with people being possessed? Do you think there's a correlation between the two?
Well, yes, I think so. I would say that a lot of mental disorders are connected to this because, see, if you were growing up in a village and you started showing certain signs or you're suicidal, they would call in the curandera and they'd be like, what happened? And then he'd say, oh, their soul. They have a soul piece missing. Let me go find it. Oh. Right? Oh, mm-hmm. there's a ghost of your aunt who hasn't crossed over, who got attached to you. So basically, they would look at your soul and be like, what's going on? They would view it as a soul sickness or an illness. Mm-hmm. And then they would, you know, and also, I mean, the stuff that I do, it does help people overcome depression. I am no medical doctor, so I cannot diagnose anyone. But I know mm-hmm. that when people have certain things going on, I know that oftentimes they have dark entities, they have mm-hmm. ghosts attached, they even have personalities. Mm-hmm. A lot of people who experience trauma have personalities. They're actually very common. Most people think it's like civil. It's very like rare. Like no, possession and personality disorder. I mean, or it's so common to me that I kind of feel like that's the big secret is that so many people have personalities, they're not even aware of them. And so, you know, when I would talk to someone, I'd find out, and then eventually I would be divinely given their file. And then I'd be like, oh, this is what's going on. And oftentimes, you know, when people suffer from depression or they're born with depression, it's because in past lives they might have done work with dark forces. Mm-hmm. And they still have contracts that need to be completed. Wow. They still have stuff going on. I mean, when people have demonic attacks, they're not random. They can't be random. They're mm-hmm. never random. There's always a reason. And I basically just have to find out how did you open the door? What sin did you commit? What contracts do you have? And I basically just got to go like a secretary, go, all right. And anyway, yeah, I developed a method where there's no drama. It's very much like a secretary taking inventory of what's going on with your soul.
Yeah. It's basically like a kind of a ledger with the balances. And at the end, then yes. you try to sort out the balance. Well, it seems like a very worthy cause. However you do it, if you can take somebody through a depression, we need that in our society because depression is one of those things, like, as you say, women and sex, it's kind of swept under the carpet. And oftentimes people who suffer from depression are not allowed to express it because there's a stigma. And so somebody working with it and being open about it and your history of depression too, that you're able to bring that in.
Well, see,
and as you said, you're an empath. So
that's what did you're basically the wounded healer. You're the wounded person. If you mm-hmm. can heal yourself, then mm-hmm. you get to be the healer. Mm-hmm. And I tell people my life story because, you know, I'm not just making this stuff up because I go, who sets out to do this? Mm-hmm. Unless this happened, like, you know, I had stuff going on that was very painful. And then I realized, oh, I had to go through this so that when someone's depressed or suicidal or hearing voices or being demonically attacked, I'm not mm-hmm. afraid because I know where they're at. I know how it feels. And then I say, look, you know, I have a great life. I have a great sense of humor. I'm very happy. Mm-hmm. It took me years to figure out that I wasn't crazy or depressed. I just had a lot of my life force was being taken away by all these energetic leeches. And also I had a soul piece missing mm-hmm. and I had a disconnect. I mean, I basically had almost everything going on with me. that when I finally repaired it, I was like, wow, this is how it feels to feel whole. Like, I didn't know what that was like. You know, I was on Prozac, and on Prozac, it gives you, I remember when I tried Prozac, I was like, oh, this is what it feels like to be quote unquote normal. I enjoyed it. But it took away all my creativity. It took away all orgasms. Yeah. So I was like, oh my God, I get to be normal.
It's a big price to pay.
Yeah. So I didn't do it that way. I said, I'm going to find a way, but I'm going to find my way. So I kind of feel like, oh wow, I have my creativity, my orgasms. I have this excitement, but I feel whole now. And so it was a different way that I had to go to be here.
There's a title for your next book, Creativity and Orgasms, right there. That's going to be a bestseller.
That's right.
And in your book, Hungry Woman in Paris, that we spoke about a little earlier, one of the characters, I believe her name was Luna, if I'm remembering rightly, actually killed herself.
It was a cousin of the protagonist.
Was that based in reality?
I did have a cousin. Who did commit suicide by drinking 6 Cokes. She was a diabetic. And she looked identical to me. She was 10 years older than I was. Mm-hmm. And when she committed suicide, I was like, oh my God, that's my greatest fear, that I'm going to commit suicide. And the fact that my cousin did it was like, wow, this is real.
So it must have been very hard to write that then.
Well, see, it was. But then I said, if I don't face it and look at death in the face and say, I see you, I'm not going to pretend I don't see you. Mm-hmm. Because if I did, then it would scare me the whole life. I wouldn't be able to do what I'm doing now. But if I said, okay, I'm going to write about the things that scares me the most, which is to constantly think about suicide. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to personify suicide as La Muerte. You know, in Mexican culture, we have La Catrina, this woman, like a skeleton that, you know, is beautiful. Mm-hmm. I'm going to personify this feeling so that I can own it and be at peace with it. And I think by taking my greatest fear and making it public in my story, I took the power away that this thing had from me.
Wow, wonderful. Well, the healing power of writing, right? And on top of everything else. Well, you know, we've gone over time, as I knew we would, but it's been a lot of fun. And thank you for spending this time with us, Josefina. We really appreciate that.
Yes, great.
And I'm getting better. You're a good teacher. And, you know, I want to thank you, as I said, for spending this time with us and for the Spanish lesson. And also, I want to congratulate you on your eldership.
Thank you. No, I tell people I'm 51 and I'm proud to be 51. I think women should be ashamed. I feel like I'm an elder. So, you know, I'm a woman now.
And we look forward to hearing about your journey in the shaman world too, because that's a very exciting chapter in your life.
Yes.
You know, I would think, like, if God is saying to you, okay, you got a new contract, you know, you'd be like I've done more than most people. You know what I mean? You've done a lot in your life, and now you gotta do more.
But I kind of feel that's the reason why I was in such a hurry to accomplish so much, because I knew that the first 50 years were mine, and the next 50 years are for God. So I think that's what it was, because I was like, really, I gotta do more, and I go, yep, 50 years. Your contract's 50 years, so I'm going to be around a long time.
Yeah, that's great. So when you turn 100, we can go have a drink and maybe you'll cook
for
us.
That's right. I'm done. Yeah, now I can cook for you.
You'll have time to chill out. Well, thank you, Josefina. I keep worrying I'm going to say it wrong. It was such a pleasure to chat to you, and I hope we get a chance to talk again soon. Thank you so much for your time.
Definitely. Invite me again, okay? Adios.
Adios. Did you hear me? I just spoke Spanish. I said adios. Well, what a wonderful guest, Josefina Lopez. Such a very, very talented woman. Has had a great journey thus far. And it sounds like the next 50 years plus are going to be just as exciting for her. And we're just delighted. We're delighted to have her with us. Wonderful guest. Now, we should actually mention our sponsors, as we always do at this time every week. Other people that I can't read, but that's okay. So what Dolly has done is just put up some of the people that contributed to our tip jar, and we really appreciate that. Thank you so much. As I said, we share it with our musical guest and also with everybody involved in putting on this show. And so every little bit helps, and if you can't afford a little bit, that's fine. We're happy to have you here. And you'll be glad you stayed, because Our musical artist is coming up right now. It's Paul Zolo, who's a singer-songwriter, a photographer, and he's the editor of American Songwriter magazine. He's also the author of several books, including Songwriters on Songwriting, Conversation with Tom Petty, and Hollywood Remembered. He's interviewed a great many of the world's finest songwriters, including Bob Dylan, Paul Simon, James Taylor, and Leonard Cohen. And just last week, he was part of a virtual press conference that featured none other than Ringo Starr. Yeah, he was online with Ringo Starr just last week. His upcoming cover story for American Songwriter is derived from his recent interview that he did with Billie Eilish and her brother Phineas. Real true musicians and songwriters. So that's going to be a great article. I'll definitely be checking that out, as I hope you will too. And Paul himself, of course, has written numerous songs, as well as having co-written songs with a number of artists, including one of our previous guests on this show, ex-Motown recording artist Severin Brown. They've written together. Paul has had the honor of recording with such greats as Art Garfunkel, who actually sings harmony on one of Paul's songs, a wonderful track called Being in the World, which is actually featured on one of Paul's two albums. He's got two albums of original songs. And currently he's working on some new songs, which he might actually get a taste of. We might actually get a taste of tonight. I mean, hopefully he's going to play something for us. So we might hear some new material, which would be awesome. Now, first, we're going to play a clip of Paul singing one of his older songs. I don't know if it's not that old, but it's at least 4 or 5 years old. And this song is called Naomi by Paul Zolo.
Battlements of buildings on 7th Avenue. Klezmer clarinets, ancient voices sing to you. Ghosts with derringers and bows forever taking aim. Fire escapes as old as God, know your Hebrew name. Like the saxophone refrain of sun on melting snow. Echoes of electric shocks from 8,000 years ago. All of the accumulations of life that wear us down. Our taxi cabs to Morristown. Naomi, still crying all night long. Naomi, this is your Kaddish song.
Paul Zolo, please welcome the man himself.
Hey, there we are.
Hey, Paul, how are you?
Very good. How are you doing? It's good to see you again.
Well, it's great to see you. Now, I have to ask, first off, is that Farley or Charlie that you're holding there?
Let me see. This is Charlie. They're pretty identical. Yeah. They have different
tails. You have to actually look at the other end to make sure.
Their tails are different. But
That's so funny. Well, we actually met them when you performed and you spoke at the John Prine series, at the Roadhouse series. I think it was just last week. We got introduced to your two cats who were rescued,
it's not
right?
Kittens. And you got to camera. I mean, you got to get them in somehow.
You got to bring, as Dolly always says, our furry friends. We got to bring our furry friends in.
You know, I want to say it the last time. Is the sound okay? It sounds very loud from my side.
Oh, no, it sounds great here. I'm happy with it.
Just as long as JJ's got it together.
They'll send us a message if there's a problem.
Last time we talked to you, you had mentioned the Bulls,
yes,
and Fenway, and you were kind, yes, of like thinking, like, how could you get that confused? But then I realized you didn't grow up in this country. You grew up in Ireland, right?
Yes, yes.
And, you know, that changes everything because we don't expect you to know American sports. And I always remember when I was growing up, this kid, Philip Hewson, came fifth grade in, mm-hmm, Wilmette, Illinois, where I lived. He was from Britain, which is a different country from here.
Mm-hmm.
And we were playing baseball, you know, softball at the recess, a playground. And he hit the ball and he didn't know where to run because he'd never played baseball.
Yeah.
I remember this girl, Karen Sheldak, I think that was her name, just screaming at him like, don't you know where to go? what an idiot. And I said, you know, he wasn't, he's not from America. Who's the idiot here? And I said, what? I think that kind of thinking has really prevailed since then, too.
Yeah, I like it. And you know, people who come from my part of the world, we know nothing about American football, and we just don't understand it. Like, it's a very hard thing to understand what actually is going on in the field. Because, like, soccer, you get it. They kick the ball. You got to get it in the goal. But it's like American football. It just doesn't seem to move very much. Basketball, right, we doesn't. Get because...
But how about cricket? Cricket is awfully confusing for us.
Yeah, yes, it is. Well, that's a British sport, and, you know, we try not to play British sports in Ireland, but
we don't
need to go into that history. Now, Paul, the last time we spoke, we had a long conversation, and man, as I said in my intro, people demanded more Zolo. So thank you for coming back and being with us again. And my feeling tonight is that we may go a little long too, but you know, let me start things off, because we didn't get a chance to chat about your early days when you started your first band. We talked a lot about the interviews that you did, and we talked about some of your new albums and stuff. But way back in the day, you had a band called Ghosters.
Yes, the Ghosters. Yeah,
Ghosters. Now, this was even before the term. It was before the internet, so we didn't have the term ghosting back then.
That's right. It was interesting.
Did you just get like fan mail and you just wouldn't answer it? Was that like
no, not at all.
Ghosted? You got no fan mail?
Hearing a previous guest talking about the unseen world and ghosts.
Yes.
I came to Hollywood and just got obsessed with the ghosts of Hollywood, specific ones too. And,
yeah.
And the history of Hollywood, which ultimately I wrote a book about Hollywood history. But it was about that. I was really kind of communing with the ghosts of F. Scott Fitzgerald and that whole crowd. Oh. You know, and I wrote songs too about the ghosts of Hollywood. So it was called The Ghosters.
So interesting. And you, of course, the book I guess you're referring to is Hollywood Remembered, where you remember all of these people of old. And then
well,
you moved
really
on.
To remembering, it's I interviewed a bunch of old timers, and I did this book about almost 20 years ago now. So it's old timers remembered back to Hollywood when it was starting with silent movies before the sign was up. Wow. I was really curious. What caused the town to change so much, and what happened to Hollywood, and to get the real history. So that's what that was about.
Well, as Terry Rowland said in one of the Roadhouse series, he said you're a historian and you capture history, and that is one part of history that probably would be gone if you did not write it down and capture it in this book. Now, the other band that you were in, and I want to ask you about this name because, you know, I always admired the band, like the Canadian band, because they call themselves The Band, because it's probably, hey, what are we going to call our band? Let's just call it The Band.
Well, they were thinking of The Crackers, and then they said, yeah, that's going to be offensive, not The Crackers, because that's the name for stupid white people in the South, Crackers.
Yeah.
So they decided not The Crackers, and they went for The Band. I think that was a good choice.
Yeah, but then you kind of went one better, and you were like, well, how are we going to name this band? Let's call it The Name. Am I right there?
So, this was like the early 80s, during that like new wave and stuff, and the lead singer of The Name, Leah Reilly, she really had one of those like really intense new wave voices. And, but the name didn't last very long because she had an affair with the drummer before we had any gigs. You know, you give it some time first.
Yeah, I mean, the rule is never sleep with the drummer. People should know that.
By now, you would think but they don't. They're still wrong.
Oh, it'll always ruin a band if the lead singer sleeps with the drummer. So then I just thought that's just classic. Like, has anybody ever taken that name since, I wonder, calling a band The Name? Like, you can't think of a name, so you just...
There was that band, The. Do you remember them?
Yeah, you know, I don't, but that's even better. They've even
serious up you. Band, actually.
Oh, that's awesome. But you guys, did you actually get as far as touring Eastern Europe? Did you go, was it that band you went over there with?
That was different, though. I did get to go on a tour of Eastern Europe, but it was as a guitarist in the band for an American musical theater review.
Okay.
It was going over there. It was a cultural exchange during the late 70s, you know, when it was still communist, USSR. And it was part of, it was people singing and dancing like Hello Dolly and songs from Greece. Mm-hmm. And they didn't really need a guitar player in the band, but the lady that was putting it together got me in on it. And
wow.
So we went to Moscow and Leningrad and Poland, and it was pretty intense.
Did you have to agree not to sleep with the drummer on the tour? So, I mean, Moscow and Leningrad, that must have been incredible. So this is Iron Curtain days, right? Before the Berlin Wall fell?
That's right. Exactly.
That must have been incredible because I mean, I remember, you know, seeing that documentary where Billy Joel went up there, and it was such a big deal for them to hear American music. You must have had that kind of experience.
Yeah, because they were not free then in any way. And wow. We knew, like, even going to Moscow, that you're going to be bugged. Your room is bugged in Moscow. So wow. My roommate and I, just to be funny, we would speak in gibberish always, you know, just to throw them off. Like, the porpoise is in the ashtray again, that kind of thing. And so we'd like the thought of the KGB working on that. You know? We got to see one of Lenin's tomb. You know, they actually have Lenin there in his tomb.
Yeah, wow.
Preserved there. I think it's preserved. Either that or it's a wax dummy, but you're not supposed to see it.
Yeah, I mean, either one, who cares at this point, right? I mean, when we're talking about that Lenin, not, you know, the Lenin who died in 1980, we're talking about the other Lenin.
Right, so, not the important Lenin, the one.
Right, exactly. The evil Lenin. So,
yeah.
Sorry, Paul, I missed that.
And that Lenin wrote no good songs at all, as far as
no, I know. No, he didn't.
So, you know, was,
that's Lenin, right. Yeah, no point in interviewing him, so... And speaking of songs, so the songs that you wrote, you know, I've been listening to Orange Avenue, and it's just a great album. It's got great reviews. You know, one review said, basically, tales and essays is what you write. And I wonder, because there's so many stories in your songs, and you're such a prolific writer in your prose, yet you manage to tell these stories, and you get each song, you know, under 5 minutes. They all seem to be like, you know, within a reasonable amount of time. Compared to your book, that's, as I always say, is like 5,000 pages. I have a little story to tell you about that later on. But so is it hard for you? There it is right there.
That's reasonable. Come on now.
Is that the Old Testament? Oh, there's the Old Testament and the New Testament. You got both of them right there?
You know all my jokes already. It's great. Yeah, this is the volume one. It finally came out as a matching set, which I just
thought. That's fantastic.
Tremendous, yeah.
It's like the other side of the record right there. But they're actually about 700 pages. I know I exaggerate, but are they like about 700 pages?
Yeah, that's right. And that's as big as you can make them. That's why I had to do a second volume.
Oh, that's hilarious. So they were like your limit is 700 pages and you use like every last leaf.
It's and just so, stuff I cut out.
Oh my God, that must have been so hard. Well, you know, you didn't seem to manage to do that in your album, because you know, the album that we were just discussing has 14 songs. Was that because you were just like, as many songs as I can possibly fit on a CD?
No, you know, because that's a different consideration. People don't want too many songs on a CD. They don't want 20 necessarily. They probably won't listen to 20.
Right.
And songs, even 5 minutes might be too long. You know, I do have a tendency, it's easier for me to write a long song, but to write one that's great in 3 minutes.
Yeah, it's hard.
Harder to discuss everything because it's such a limited form. But some of my songs, I think, might be a little too long.
And do you spend a lot of time editing them, trying to get them down under 5 minutes?
Yeah, I never stop. You know, even songs that I finish, it's like, well, maybe that is a good verse. You know, I was looking like for stuff for tonight. It's like, you know, that verse you cut out, Paul, you know, maybe put that back in. It's like, no. You know, you constantly fight with yourself.
It's really a never-ending road. Because you see, I would think, like, if you're making an album, you've got 14 songs, you think, well, put 10 songs on there, and then you got enough, you know, for like a third of the next album. But I guess, you know, I guess what you're doing is you're writing a theme, right? Would you have a theme in mind
or
for that
just
album?
Like crazy and think, I could get hit by a train tomorrow. I better get as much done here right now. Who knows if there's going to be a tomorrow? I think
so. Fear of death. Fear of death is your motivation. I love it.
I kind of think in those terms, like, just let's, you know, we're here now, this is working, let's get as much done.
Yeah, that's actually a great way of looking at it. And you've got variety on that album too. I mean, I know there's what the title track is just kind of stripped back, and you've just got piano there for pretty much the first half, maybe some harmonies before the string comes in. Is that you playing piano?
That is me playing piano.
Oh wow, I'm impressed.
I love to play piano. That's a real piano song. That one
wouldn't
have been born on guitar. That's from being very sad and playing piano, but I love playing piano.
Yeah, but interesting in that song, you know, last time we spoke, you talked about serving the song, what serves the song. And at that point, all you needed really was. But then, you know, there are other tracks on there that there are heartfelt. But I mean, there's other tracks like Human Sunlight, and it's very layered. You seem to have, you know, done almost a Sgt. Pepper on there, where it's like, you know, how many tracks do we have? Let's throw many things on there, and it's, you know, it throws in variety. The thinking behind that, when you're arranging, do you you and the producer, you just try to put some extra stuff in and see if it works, and if it works, you keep it in?
Well, it's not that delicate or careful, but you know, I produced that pretty much myself, except Human Sunlight. Uh-huh. I produced with kind of a hip-hop producer. I wish I could remember his name. Bruce Wilson, kind of a urban hip-hop, like country mm-hmm. hip-hop. So that one was a little different because it had mechanized drums on it. This was the first time I didn't have real drums. But my tendency is to overproduce. It's a lot easier to overproduce. It's like to overwrite.
Yes.
I think we need xylophone now, and tuba would be good. We need to harmonium, you know, and it's harder to find all the elements and then strip it down, but it sounds better. It took me a while, like every lesson, it took me a while to learn it. I had to do it wrong first, but that silence and space mm-hmm. music really matters, you know, dynamics, you know.
Yeah, as they say, the space between the notes, and of course, dynamics are hugely important. Well, an example is Being in the World. The last time we spoke, you said Art Garfunkel basically chose the more stripped back version arrangement to put on your album, because you basically went, which was, I think, a very good move, basically, to go with his choice of which recording to put on. But that's very stripped back. I mean, I don't think you have any drums on there. I think, if I remember rightly, it's fretless bass and guitar.
Right. You know, I came up with the Beatles, you know, on the radio, and Herman's Hermits and all these bands. And I had this idea, like, if it doesn't have drums and bass, it's not a real record. Let's face it.
Yeah.
It's amateur. You know, it always kind of seems incomplete. And it's not at all, you know what I mean?
I know.
I've really learned that. It has to do with the song. And And sometimes that is much more powerful.
And I mean, drums can take from it, you know, because people won't listen to the, you know, they're caught up in the beat. But it's interesting. That's why Human Sunlight stuck out to me, because I guess it was, you know, you had a different producer on it, and it did still fitting in with the theme of the album and everything. But I mean, speaking of themes, like you seem to write a lot about heartache and relationships and people. I know that there's one song where you talk about, like, my purple heart. I think somebody's looking over the balcony and it's my purple. I wondered, is that a reference to a veteran, or was that just the, it is, okay.
Well, no, not a specific.
Right.
But purple heart referring to that I got awarded for the hurt I suffered in battle.
Right.
It's not a literal purple heart, but that was the idea.
I figured it was metaphoric, but it's a great way of not saying I was wounded in battle and just saying I'm standing here with my purple heart, you know? And you know, so you write about a lot of people, you know, so that song that we heard in the intro, is that Naomi? Is Naomi a real person?
Excuse me. Naomi was a real person. That was actually based on the poem Kaddish by Allen Ginsberg, the poet.
Ah.
And I just thought it'd be interesting because I love that poem. And I was saying, I'll just write something outside of myself. And really, it's a poem about, he's in California and his mother's dying in New York, and he's worried he's not going to get there. In fact, he didn't get there when she died. And so he wrote this long, Kaddish is the Jewish prayer for the dead that he wasn't able to give.
Wow.
And then I realized that it's not so far. You know, I'm here in California. My mother is 90. She's in a nursing place in Chicago. You know, sometimes you realize, oh, this song's not so far, but some of the language and the ideas came from Allen Ginsberg. With the music, it was influenced by Steely Dan.
The song Scam. Yeah, they got some great stuff with great mixes. Steely Dan mixes, like, just blow your mind.
Well, I'm just feeling their chords. So if you play, like, Steely Dan chords, that's like going to the College of Musical Knowledge there. You know, it's pretty intense stuff. It's great. You know?
I know you use a lot of what you call adult chords, right? it's interesting because last time we spoke, there was a chord, and you didn't say this on the air. It was when we were hanging out a little before or after, that Paul Simon had taught you a chord that, like, had a fourth in it or something. So here's a question.
He showed me a number of chords, but he was often showing me the half diminished too.
Oh wow!
Like this one. Like if you're here, this one.
Wow.
It's the chords between the chords.
Yeah. Well, it's like that space you're talking about, but also, you know, what an honor to get a guitar lesson from Paul. I mean, I just got a Spanish lesson from Josefina Lopez. So, you know, you and I were on the same level now, my friend.
Well, it was interesting. I played some of my songs for Paul in New York. You know, I asked him if he would mind, and he said no. So I brought a guitar.
Yeah.
You know, from here, he said, you know, I have guitars. You didn't have to
like it's like going to the desert and saying, I brought some sand.
But the things he did often, he was like very interested in the guitar parts. You know, he's a songwriter, but he's a guitarist too. And he goes, that's similar to this. And he was often showing me things, you know, things that he's passing chords and things that he learned. And he learned stuff from the Africans too, that he was learning from Greece and these different chord things.
Wow. That is amazing. I mean, one of the things that you said about Paul Simon that's very inspiring was inspiring to me, and I think it was in one of your articles, that he embraces the whole process of writing and recording. So a lot of ours would bemoan the recording process, whereas Paul Simon, he embraces it and enjoys the whole thing, right?
Yeah. I think some, you know, that's the challenge, to get it where it can be joyful, where you can record. Tom Petty got to the place where he learned that recording didn't have to be torturous. Paul Simon became convinced that he didn't produce, he didn't do a good job on Hearts and Bones, so he had to get better. Wow. But he was working with Roy Halley, who produced and engineered all those Simon and Garfunkel albums too, and that guy knows sonics. So when they went to Africa and they recorded those tracks and all those percussions, it sounded sonically beautiful. And the idea was, if I just make a good album, then I'll just write songs to that. How can you go wrong?
But, So that was his method at that point, right? Was just basically getting the beat and then writing to that rather than
the beat and the chords. Yeah. I mean, it wasn't just it was like these guitars and all. I mean, it was chords and then, you know, he did edit them, but
It's interesting because I mean, the recording process, I've been finding it tedious. And that's why I say it kind of helps me, because, you know, when I Bob Dylan's memoir, when I was reading that, and he talked about recording being really tedious and he didn't want to make any more albums. And this is, I guess, when he was only in his 40s or something. And I think he'd been working with Daniel Lanois, and he was just had that experience in New Orleans where like everything was going wrong. And he was
Lanois breaks a guitar.
Oh, is that what happened? He broke the guitar in the...
And Dylan goes, Daniel, are we still friends? You know, you're Dylan, you know, geez.
Yeah, but he was just talking about, like, just how tedious it was. And I was like, well, if Dylan finds it tedious, what hope is there for me? But then reading that article on Paul Simon kind of helped me. It's like the whole thing is an art, you know.
Dylan wasn't about that it was tedious, because he would generally record live with the band.
Yeah.
His thing was not that it was tedious, but it was really hard to get the right feel.
Yes.
And sometimes he thought Daniel Lanois was just swamping it up too much, or other times when he just wasn't getting the feel, he just wasn't getting what he wanted. But he's unlike many people. Other people will be as tedious as necessary, you know, really, you know, spend a lot of time in the studio, and modern technology lends itself to that too. But Dylan liked to get in there and record and, you know, get that moment and get out of there.
Yeah, it was so much more fun, you know what I mean, with the band, if you can just get it down like that. Well, speaking of fun, Paul, I think we're going to move on to a couple of songs, if you don't mind. The powers that be have let us chat for quite a while, and I'm very grateful for that. But I think if you can grace us with a couple of songs, we'd really appreciate that.
Well, if you insist, I'd be happy to.
Fantastic. Ladies and gentlemen,
powers that be, Dolly and JJ.
Dolly and JJ.
Oh, nice to be back. And I ran into Manda today. You guys know Manda, right? Manda Moshe.
I don't. They might know her.
But I know Dolly knows her. And I was saying it's really trippy having these gigs, and yet you don't leave home. But it's still a gig. You still get all nervous.
Yeah, you still get to hang out with people. It's really cool, you know.
Yeah.
It's like a social life. I mean, every Monday night, I know I'm going to be chatting to really cool people. So. I always look forward to it. You know, it's funny when you're talking about that poem inspired by Allen Ginsberg, because one of the things that he really wanted, and this is according to a Dylan documentary, was when Allen Ginsberg was touring around with Dylan, he was jealous that like he couldn't get the reaction for his poems that Dylan would get for his music, because, you know, lyrics and songs, the songs are what really grab people. And Dylan was actually saying that, like, Allen Ginsberg, he was kind of jealous that he wasn't a songwriter.
Mm-hmm. I know. There you go.
Yeah, I'm sure he would have appreciated that. I'm sure he would have appreciated that song that you wrote. That
Dylan got so much from Allen Ginsberg and those beat writers and that language and that electricity with words. He wouldn't have been Dylan if not for that. That's where it came from, a lot of it.
Yeah, well, I guess they all learn, as you say, and I believe you told me this, that it was it from Pete Seeger, that saying that we're all links in a chain?
Yes, Pete Seeger, in fact. And Dylan and Pete Seeger had a connection, a strong connection.
Yeah, and I guess that's just it. Like the poets, the artists, you know, no matter what discipline you're in, we're all inspired by each other. And so anyway, I don't want to get into trouble, Paul. So if you're ready to go, my friend, the floor is all yours. Ladies and gentlemen, Paul Zolo.
Thank you very much. Nice to be here. And yeah, songwriters that read some great poetry by Ginsberg or those guys, Ferlinghetti. If you ever hear how Ferlinghetti delivered poetry, it sounds like Dylan's. And then I walked down the street. It's like, oh, that's where it came from. I'm going to start with a song called Lucinda. This isn't a Los Angeles song. Sleigh bells on trees, old abalone shells, blue Christmas lights strung up all year. Around the old bamboo, you broke my heart, then you tried to patch it up again, but it's never been the same. Sealing wax and crazy glue, you know they just don't seem to stick, just don't do the trick, and that is why I love you like I do, even after all the hell you put me through. Ain't nobody in the world loves me like you do, Lucinda. Lucinda, Lucinda, we rode down to the pier where the big Pacific waves come crashing into California. Every smile, smile at me, I'm photographing. We skate down to the pier where the mystic ferris wheel forever spins over the ocean. I can hear the face of God looking down. I can tell he's laughing. That is why I love you like I do. Even after all the hell you put me through, ain't nobody else in this world can love me like you do. Lucinda, Lucinda, Lucinda. We sang all through the night every love song I'd ever write for you, in spite of everything. Everything still sleeps in our bed of nails down by the marina. And we fight all the old fights that we've been fighting since the days of the dinosaurs on Venice Beach, who roller skate past our house of cards with my subpoena. That is why I love you like I do, even after all the hell that you put me. There ain't nobody in this world who can love me like you do. Lucinda, 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 Lucinda. Yeah, that was Lucinda. Let me adjust this. It's sounding very distorted here. Yeah, is that all right? DJ, let me know if I'm messing it up too much. But well, I'm going to do another song. We played Naomi. I have many songs named after women. I have some songs named after men, which I can't think of any right now. But there's probably are some. But I like old names too, you know. Naomi, Lucinda, obviously. Isn't it great when your tuner stops working just when you need it? This one I did play last time, but it was in tune then too. Actually, I could get a tuner up here. This one is it's called Kathleen, and I did get it from Tom Waits. He was in an interview talking about his wife. I'm so hoarse for some reason. I don't know why. And someone asked him, you know, what's Kathleen like? That's his wife. And he said, Kathleen is a rhododendron. She's an orchid. She's an oak. I thought, you know, that's a perfect opening for a song there. I got an online tuner here. I got, if this G is not in tune, you know, it's all about this drop G here. Guitarists, it'll just bug you, I know. So so this is called Kathleen. It's one of those little songwriter prompts I gave myself. And it's good to do these if you, you know, you're not writing. Give yourself an assignment. Let me find this again. I lost us. Where are we? Oh, there we are. Hi. Excuse me. Kathleen's a rhododendron. She's an orchid. She's an oak. You have to find a line that fits metrically and, you know, works musically. And there you go. That's your night ahead of you. You know, that's the fun of being a songwriter. So this is called Kathleen. Rhododendron, she's an orchid, she's an oak. She'll always help me to pick the pieces up and sweep away what's broke. She's my four-leaf clover, she's my lucky charm. Whatever we canoe, she gets us through the rapids with no harm. It's just the kind of girl she is. She's got a whole lot of love to give. And if she wasn't the love of my life, I'd have no life to live. Would have no life. No sense of direction. I can get lost in a cul-de-sac, just going round and round, never being found. But she can always bring me back. She is my spiritual mechanic. She's my mystical chimney sweep. She'll always answer me harmony if I start singing in my sleep. Mm-hmm. just the kind of girl she is. She's got a whole lot of love to give. And if she wasn't the love of my life, I'd have no life to live. I would have no life. Kathleen is a jacaranda. She is a blue magnolia leaf. She's an amateur conquistador, a siren and a thief. My yellow sparrow, she's my magpie, she's my dove, she's the giddy girl on the tilt-a-whirl who fills my world with love. She's just the kind of girl she is. She's got a whole lot of love to give. And if she wasn't the love of my life, if she wasn't the love of my life, if she wasn't the love of my life, I'd have no life to live. I would have no life. No love. Kathleen,
that was beautiful. Thank you, Paul. I actually remember you played that when you were last with us, and I think it might have been the first time that you played it, because you wrote it during the lockdown, right?
That's right. I got it down to now, you know. I kind of learned it better.
Wow. Well, it got a lot of great reaction last time, so I'm sure it is this time. I remember people commenting on Kath, and they were spelling it all different ways, and people were saying, how do you, is it with a K or a C? They wanted to know all about that song.
It was nice. Great. It was a wonderful reception. It was really great.
You know what's so funny? You were talking earlier about the poem being delivered like in the Bob Dylan fashion, and that's how you got it. As soon as you said Tom Waits, your voice got hoarse. You were like, why is my voice hoarse? I'm like, dude, you mentioned Tom Waits. Mentioned the devil appears. Well, we're going to do something different now, Paul. That was beautiful. We're going to keep you for a little longer, if that's okay.
Sure.
And by a little, I mean about 4 hours. So hopefully the cats don't need to be fed. We've decided, because so many people have read your book, and your books, rather, I should say, plural, and are curious and they have their questions, why should I get to ask all the questions? So it was suggested by our fearless leader, Dolly, that we get some people in the community to ask some questions. And so we're going to go to a couple of people now who've kindly sent in some videos of their questions. And I believe the first one is from our friend Jimmy Yamagishi from Pasadena, California. So he's got a question for you.
Hey, Paul, how's it going? Jimmy Yamagishi here. You know, I've always wondered, you get to interview some of the most legendary and famous artists in the world. And how do you get access? How do you find these people? How do you make that connection and meet them and actually get that opportunity? Because for a lot of us anyway, you know, access is pretty limited. So you must have some good connections. Let us know about that. Thanks.
Well, what I do is I follow them. You know, I stalk. I employ several detectives. It's dangerous work. No, luckily I was doing these for various publications. It started for Song Talk, which was the journal of the National Academy of Songwriters, which meant like not Rolling Stone. But I did work for Musician occasionally, but you have to go through the proper channels, and they have publicists. So the time they do interviews is when there's a new album generally. That's when they need to do interviews. And so that's when I would start my begging and pleading, or my polite persistence, as I called it. But there were some people, you know, they put out an album, they do maybe four or five interviews of that, and I wouldn't get one. But every year I would bother, I would kindly persist. But it's been so long now that, you know, people know me for so long, you know, but it took a long time to get established where they would even take me seriously. Like when I first asked for an interview for Dylan, they laughed at me. Same thing with Michael Jackson. I kept calling back. We think it's really funny. You keep calling, but no, he's not going to do it. But you know, ultimately Dylan did it. I didn't get Michael, unfortunately.
Well, it's interesting because I guess you reverse the flow. So you keep doing it and then you get some people on board. And I think, wasn't it Dylan saw the interview you did with Paul Simon and then he wanted to do it with you and you got a one-on-one with Dylan, which is so rare in those days too, you know?
That's often what happened. You know, they saw other ones. The one that really established me was when I did Randy Newman, because I love Randy and really know his stuff. And we had a great connection. And mm-hmm. And it was, you know, a really in-depth interview. And people really noticed that. They were like, wow, it's like a real interview with the songwriter.
I guess that's what happens. And then they're searching you out because they want that interview for themselves. So I guess what Jimmy and the rest of us are asking, could you kindly forward us Bob Dylan and Paul Simon's phone number so we can just post it for our community?
Well, I could send you, you know, who I write. You know, I don't write them directly. And, you know, like Dylan's manager is very nice. I appreciate when people say no. Some people you get the no answer at all, which is annoying. But Dylan's will often say, yeah, thank you for it. Because I've asked him for another interview several times. And they say, thank you, but no. But at least you'll say no.
I get it. He doesn't want to do it anymore. But you had that one great interview. So, you know, that's more than help a lot of people. But I guess what you're saying, and, you know, you start and you keep doing it. And then they want to come to you. And that's
you know,
basically how you
years,
do it.
Too. It wasn't like they lined up. You know, it took years.
Yeah, of course.
6 years before, I think, or 5 years before I got Paul Simon. Wow. That was one of my big goals, Paul Simon. And then, you know, it was like a sport. I'd go to work every day and just like, you know, email people and just like go after it. And it's not like it came easy. And there were, frankly, some people I couldn't get and drove me crazy.
Yeah.
And I tried other means and that often backfired.
Well, we don't need to talk about it now, but I remember a story once you told about Bruce Springsteen, which was very funny. But we'll talk about that another time. Maybe in another interview, I want to question about that, because I remember that story. We're going to move on to another question, if that's okay. We got a bunch of them, so get comfortable, Paul.
I'm home. How can I be more comfortable?
Great, and thank you for doing this. This is so much fun for me, and I'm sure everybody watching. This is just great.
I love this. We can do this every night if you want. I love this.
I'm free tomorrow night. Let's go. So let's start now. Our next question comes from a chap also in Los Angeles, and his name is R.J. Chesney.
All right.
And this is his question.
Hey, Paul. Both in journalism and songwriting, do you ever get writer's block? And what do you do to focus yourself to kind of block out the world and get that story or message that you are trying to deliver?
Well, that's a complex thing to answer. In terms of writer's block, I think it's very detrimental for any writer to even use that term or think in those terms, because then you create a psychological block. You make it more formidable than it is. You just have days that maybe you're exhausted or for whatever reason, it's not happening. But you don't have to say, I'm blocked. That's it. This is the beginning of a block. I'll probably never write again. You know, it's like you're making things worse. But as far as keeping the world out and staying focused, that's the challenge. I mean, it's so easy to get derailed so easily, especially now in modern times. I find like I'm an old man. It's like I spend half of my time trying to remember my passwords. I have 7,000. I never knew I'd have to remember so many passwords. You're constantly changing them and you want to go check one, but you have to get the password for that one to check that one. And there's just so many of those kind of modern things. And in my work right now with American Songwriter, I do a lot of writing, which I enjoy. I like the writing. And it's interesting because I'm writing mostly for online, which is different. But then I post the stories, and the posting of stories, that could take a lot of time. It could be very time consuming, and it doesn't work out right. So that's a challenge, to stay in a good place. And I don't think people who are not writers, they don't understand that if something's really fucked or not going well or you're depressed, it's hard to do good work, creative work. It's really hard. And people are like, come on, just sit down and just write your thing. You know,
yeah, it's impossible.
Yeah.
Well, it's interesting. One of the articles you wrote in American Songwriter, I think quite recently, was Tom Petty's, is it Southern Accent? Is that the song that came to him at like 4 a.m. or something? And so that, I would imagine this is probably what happens with you, is something just comes and you have to write it down. It's a moment. I think ephemeral is the word that he used, or maybe you used it in his place. And so do you have those moments where you're not really thinking about writing and then it just comes and you got to write it down?
Yeah. Those are good moments. When I love that when it happens. When you sometimes will have four lines that rhyme. It's like, wow. Or melody a lot of times.
Yeah.
And I more than ever. But that's the good thing about being a songwriter, too. And same thing with writing about music. It's not an easy thing to do. Mm-hmm. It's not as hard as writing a good song. But it took me a while to really kind of get into it. But often I'll be walking around doing something else, and then I'll think that's how to start that piece. You know, stuff comes to you often when you're not too focused on it often. But I'm kind of always working on stuff.
Well, I guess it's, as they say, you get out of your own way, and hopefully it comes.
You have to make a good, you know, a physical situation where you're comfortable, where you're working. Yeah. Make everything easy on you as possible.
Okay, great. Well, thank you, and thank you.
That is the hard challenge, and you have to just make it work and not give up and stay hopeful.
Oh yeah, absolutely. Well, that's great. Thank you, Paul, and thank you, RJ, for that question. RJ. Our next question comes from Laura Ramirez, all the way out in West Hills, California.
All right.
Hi, Paul. I'm Laura Ramirez, and I'm a big fan of your books, and I wanted to ask, what were some of your best songwriting tips as someone who's interviewed some of the greatest songwriters of our time? Thanks.
You know, one of the biggest ones, well, there's several, but Randy Newman said, don't let the critic become bigger than the creator while you're doing it. And Randy Newman, someone whose songs are very, you know, distinctive. He doesn't write what just comes through. They're unique to him and complex songs, but I understood what he meant, that while you're writing a song and it's coming through, don't start questioning it then. Go, oh, that's stupid line, you know. Get out of that, you know, because that will kill it. And Ricky Lee Jones, several people said the same thing. Like, it's a living spirit right then. You could kill it right then. You have to nurture it. Wow. And Tom Petty was great at that. Everyone gets, you know, if you're a serious songwriter, you learn how to do that. And also Laura Nero, who I just loved, and She said, you know, remember, there's joy here. This is about joy. We're playing music. Music is joyful. So it's a serious thing, but it's play. So she calls it her serious playground. So I think those are the most important things, like enjoy it. And so many times I found when I'm having fun, those are the songs that are good, because while you're having fun, that fun gets injected into the song. But if you're struggling with it or laboring, what I want to say to the world, or any kind of labor into it, will kind of get in the way of the song being free. And as you said, that's the whole challenge, getting out of your way. That's why it's such a funny pursuit to create these little delicate things, words and music. It's such a delicate, ancient thing. And you can't just contrive it. I mean, every great songwriter said, no, you know, sometimes it just comes to you. Like, where did that come from? And it's always about kind of discovering something. It's not about, yes, bridge over troubled water. That will work, you know. I mean, it's never
right. Yeah, where does that come from? I mean, it's what a great line and what a great image. But I guess it's that thing. It was another songwriter I was speaking to recently is kind of really mirroring what you say. Is like, it doesn't have to go on the album. So it's like you're writing it. If it's crap, it's crap. You don't show it to anybody. You know what I mean? But
absolutely,
that's really good advice to just let it flow and have fun. Because if we're brought up with a work ethic, as many of us have been, you think in order to create something good, you really got to try and work hard. But
that's right. It's, you know, even funny, it's even famous songwriters that'll write a song quickly, like Hanky Panky, Jeff Berry and Ellie Greenwich wrote it 15 minutes. So they think it's no good because they didn't work on it. But sometimes what comes through is great.
Yeah. It's just an interesting profession. It's so really unlike anything else, because sometimes the hard work actually cannot pay off and not work, you know, just being in a relaxed environment or just this inspiration and then writing. Well, that's a great answer.
You can't get too detached from it. You can't go away from songwriting too long and try to come back to it. I think the best way to do it is to constantly be writing, like get on a roll. That's the way most people that have really written a lot, they're kind of on a songwriting roll.
Yes.
Enjoying it. But also what you said about... no one has to hear it. It doesn't have to go on the album. That's very important. I do that myself, where I kind of trick myself. It's like, okay, Paul, Just write one for fun. No one will ever hear this, ever.
Yeah.
Just for fun. Yes. Make it as weird as you want to. And then invariably I'll get into it and it'll become one, it becomes a real song, you know. And
yeah.
And I talk to other people about it. It's like, yeah, they trick themselves into like writing a song. Peter Gates was talking about that. Different ways of tricking yourself.
Right. And going back to the critic earlier on that we were speaking of, I remember you were saying when I saw you at SongNet, when you gave that great 2-hour talk that was just life changing, I have to say. You mentioned James Taylor, who got a bad review one time and he was blocked for like 5 years or something.
Yeah, that was really interesting and sad to realize, but informative that even a great songwriter at that level, who knows that millions of people love his songwriting and singing. They and Rolling Stone, they said of the confessional songwriters, James Taylor must be the worst or the most painful to listen to. And people that write songs, as you know, take things deeply. We're sensitive people.
Of course.
Especially people that write out of heartache, which is all songwriters.
Yes.
So when you hear something like that, it's not just about something distant from James Taylor. That's about the songs and that's his soul they're talking about.
Yes.
And it's not even accurate. I mean, he had a lot of story songs too, but he took that very deeply. But I heard that so many times. And Paul Simon, he didn't sell well. He thought he failed. You know, it's a sense of failure. It's hard for me to realize that.
I know there's articles I've read on songwriters that say, like, you know, that they think their stuff is bad or they were blocked just because. And I think, like, there's songs I love and songwriters I love. And I just go, I just want to see that guy on the street and say, I love your songs. Like, keep going. It's amazing. But I guess just that's what they say, that one criticism, and it can block you up. Well, we're going to move on to the next question.
But I must say, if you're a songwriter, you got to get used to rejection or criticism, because anyone feels that they are justified because they know songs. I got to tell you, that's a bad song. So you got to be ready for that. You're putting your heart really out there in the world in a big way. And if you can't handle that, you're not going to enjoy doing this.
Right. Well, it's a hard thing because you have to be vulnerable in your presentation of the song and in your writing of the song. So you leave yourself open and then you get whacked on the head. Well, thank you so much. Thank you for that question, Laura. Great. And as she said, she's a big fan of your books. She's got Songwriting on Songwriters. I think she's got both volumes and she's read them all. And this next gentleman also has read your book. He's read the first volume, and it's coming all the way from Woodland Hills. This is Michael Shipley.
Hi, Paul. Loved the book. Thank you so much. And I only realize now that you have a second one out, so I'm going to go get that one too. Here was my question. Reading all these interviews with all these different songwriters, certain patterns seemed like they were starting to emerge about ways people approach things. Who was the songwriter that you felt had the most idiosyncratic and unique way of approaching songwriting? Thanks very much.
That's an interesting question, because really the great songwriters, they wrote pretty much in the same way, serious, diligent work. It wasn't like they were doing it while hang gliding or something. They were there in the room or at the piano or guitar. But the strangest ones, I think, would have to be Jules Shear. You know Jules, of course.
I do. I've met him. Yeah,
you're a fan, and Jules is one of those secret heroes. But he's great. He wrote All Through the Night that Cyndi Lauper did, and also If She Knew What She Wants, the Bengals did. And great songwriter. If you haven't heard Jules, great melodies. And he said one of his techniques was, for a while, he had a tent in his basement, and he would go and get in the tent with his paper and pad and guitar, and he couldn't come out of the tent till he had a song.
Wow.
That was the only time I've heard the tent method,
yeah, that's great. So basically he's got a deadline. If I ever want to get out of here, I have to do a good song.
That was an odd one. You know, people have other funny ones like that, but
yeah.
You know, Paul Simon, when he was writing Graceland, he did the tracks and then he sat there with a rubber ball and threw it against the wall while he was thinking of the lyrics. And I said, why? He goes, well, if you like to throw a ball, if you like baseball, it's such a comforting thing. It's meditative. It just kind of felt good. But he also said, and several people said this too, that they think of it while driving, that often having tracks while driving is good. But Simon also said, and that's also why you don't want to be on the road while you're near me while I'm driving.
So you're trying to ride as you're... Well, I think the guy was at Neil Finn from Crowded House. I think he said he got a lot of his ideas while he's mowing the lawn in his home. And so, wow.
You know, Neil Young, at his home up in Northern California, he had his barn and he had the big house, and he had one giant speaker of each side in each, you know, left and right. And then he'd go out on his lake in a boat and blast it. And he'd go like, more barn, until he got the perfect mixture. Listen to it out on the lake. Oh, that's a good technique.
Oh, I love it. And even Old Man Look at My Life, that actually is about a real guy on his ranch, apparently. There was a guy working there. He inherited the guy that came with the ranch that he bought. And he saw him one day and he just said, oh, yeah, I'm a lot like you or whatever. And there was a song, you know?
I didn't realize that. But, you know, that is another aspect. I want to mention truth, using truth from your life. Even if people aren't aware that it's your truth, it brings a real resonance to the song. Mm-hmm. Grounds the song in a way. And it's surprising how often I've talked to songwriters and they make a point of, well, that's because I saw a Yellow Railroad. I'm not just contriving these images.
Right.
But I find that when people do write about their personal truth, it gives the song kind of an authority, especially if you're the singer too, and you could believe the singer in a great way.
Right. And as they say, the more personal you make it, the more universal. So if it is about your life, other people are going to relate.
Absolutely.
You know, wow, that's great. And that was a great question from Michael Shipley. I have to tell you a little bit of trivia here on this, on Michael, actually. He was one of our guests a couple of weeks ago, and I was telling him that you were coming on the show. He's an executive producer in Hollywood. He wrote for Family Guy. He worked with Chocolate. I mean, but he's also a musician and a songwriter. And he read your book. He bought your book some time ago, now some years ago. You're songwriting on songwriters on songwriting. And he said, oh, I'm going to read this while I go to Iceland on holidays, right, on vacation. And the book was too heavy, so he was packing his luggage. He's like, oh, man, this is too heavy. I can't take it. So he opened it, right, to like the middle page, and he tore the book in half. Oh, my and goodness. He took the first half with him. And then he read the second half when he got back. And I thought, oh, my God, I have to tell you that story.
I think that's a great approach.
Yeah.
Not reading the book at all.
Absolutely. Well, he's originally from Santa Cruz, and he grew up knowing Tom.
Bible would have done that. We'll rip it in half.
Yeah, well, that actually, I mean, you might get into trouble for that, but he's from Santa Cruz, and so he was kind of excited to see that Tom Lehrer was in there, because he grew up knowing Tom Lehrer.
Tom Lehrer.
Is that how you say Tom Lehrer?
Yeah. It's like a baseball reference for you right now. But
yeah, I know exactly. Well, I've heard Tom Lehrer
is not well known. He was in the 50s, kind of an obscure guy, but wrote a genius comedy songs and then disappeared. So
yeah, people. Well, I remember that one. Like, isn't it Poisoning Pigeons in the Park? Yeah. Like, you could only get away with that in the '50s.
Yeah, he was like the Charles Adams of songwriting. Really, really dark songs for the '50s.
So I think his real name is Tom Lehrer, but he was using Lehrer to disguise himself. You see, it's like the Bulls and the Cubs. Let's not go there, my friend. Let's not go there. Well, we're going to move on now. We got another question, and this is another question that's coming from our friend Jimmy Yamagishi from Pasadena. And so here's Jimmy.
Hey, Paul. Jimmy Yamagishi here. I had a question. You know, you get a chance to interview some of the most legendary musicians and artists in the world. And I was just wondering, do you ever get a chance to jam or play with these guys? Or would you? I'm just kind of curious. Thanks.
No, I wouldn't, because it's very important to keep the journalist separate from the musician. Lying, of course. I never have journalistic ethics, of course. Rarely have I done that, because I did feel that, especially at the beginning, it was necessary to establish myself that I'm serious doing this. I'm not just here to give you my tape. Though occasionally I'd want to share my music with someone like a Harry Nilsson, and P.F. Sloan got to be a really good friend. And Simon, he and I got really close because he liked that I really knew his stuff and I knew everything he'd ever said. You know, he liked my obsessional knowledge of every aspect of his life, but in a respectful way. So he hired me to do liner notes. So I got to hang out with him a lot. And at one point I asked him if I could play songs. So I did get to play songs for him. But that was rare that I ever actually sat down and played songs for someone like that.
Wow. Well, that's great. You mentioned Harry Nilsson. So you hung out with him too. And did you guys play songs together?
No, we didn't. But I hung out with him thanks to the great Van Dyke Parks, who introduced me. Van Dyke's done this several times. He said, Paul, would you like to talk to my friend Harry? It's like, Harry Nilsson? Yes. Wow. He's like one of these people that connects people. But Harry was just such a sweetheart that I didn't normally want to give my tape, but I did give him my tape. And he was very sweet. Randy Newman, too. We got close, and I gave him my music. And he was very nice. He called me. And he, I remember he at one point said, so how's that ghost band doing? You know, because he was talking about the Ghosters. How's that ghost band doing? He kind of remembered that and listened to my stuff. So, you know, occasionally. And Garfunkel, you know, I got to sing with Garfunkel. But,
yeah, of course. Well, that's amazing. And you know, giving your stuff to, well, Harry Nilsson, what a great recording artist, too. You know, I mean, as you know, he didn't tour very much. He just did a lot of his stuff in the studio. He never toured, right?
Wow. Right, he didn't like to perform live. Very rarely did he ever perform live at all.
Yeah, but what great records that he made.
Oh, amazing. So, lost him too young.
Yes, I think he was early 50s, I think, wasn't he? He had a heart attack or something?
Yeah.
So we're going to move on now, Paul, to another question. Now, this is not a video. This was sent in via email, and this is from Noe Torres of Valley Village.
I love Noe.
His question is, Paul, currently, what is your favorite camera shop?
Well, the Village camera shop right there in the middle of North Hollywood.
You see, what I'm guessing is he runs the Village. Is it his camera shop?
He has taken it over. It hasn't always. It's been there a long time, right next to a very old post office. You know, I don't know if you guys remember, we could go out, you know, in public places and do things inside. And
vaguely.
One of those wonderful stores, and I'm so glad it's still here, that is a real store. It's owned by people that know what they're talking about. It's not just part of Target or something where you can get cameras. It's a wonderful place. And Henry Diltz, a legendary photographer, goes there often, so it's the place to be. Noe knows what he's doing. He's a very sweet man, too.
Wow. So he's been there a few years. Well, you know,
Noe's been there a long, long time. He worked for the guy that he's been there a long time, but he took it over. And I think it's probably more successful than ever, though. You know, lockdown hasn't been so great on it.
Well, I'm sure it's been hard, but, you know, Noe, if you're watching on our show, you just got Paul Zolo to do a plug for your store. So you are now a sponsor, my friend, if you're watching, wherever you are.
I'm happy.
We'll be sending you an invoice for that. Okay, let's move on. Next, we've got, they put this one in. All right.
Uh-oh.
You're going to love this one. Just play the video. I want nothing to do with this, Paul. Just roll. Okay, and Jessica, you have a question for Paul?
Yes, I do. So, you know your cats? I'm just wondering, like, you know, what kind of food you feed them in the morning, or?
No. Question about songwriting.
Oh, yeah, so like, you know, when you're, do your cats know you're a songwriter? Or do they think maybe you're just kind of put on the planet just for them? You know, cats are like that.
No, ask them, like, about music and songwriting, anything to do with music.
Oh, right, yeah, so when you're playing your music and you're like coming up with these great ideas and you're really into it, you know, are your cats, are they into it with you, or are they kind of like annoyed by it? I'm just curious, you know?
Yeah, forget it.
Oh.
I love that. That was great.
Well, it's like when you say you did well interviewing all these songwriters because you're a musician and you know about the music and you didn't ask them about other things. You talked about the music. And so I just thought that was kind of fun.
Yet I don't consider cats unrelated to songwriting in any way. In fact, an appreciation of cats I consider a sign of an enlightened personality, generally an enlightened or evolved spirit. Mm-hmm. Because cats can be kind of very helpful with songwriting. They really can. They're great. They're kind of beaming in energy all the time. And I don't think I'd write any songs if not for cats being around.
So that perhaps is the secret, because the last time we spoke, you said there's no rules, there's no secret. It's not like something that you can give people that you've learned from these songwriters, that this is how you write a song. Like, there's no, people don't know how it happens, but maybe cats are the answer.
Certain things that help. Some people turn to weed, you know, there's, you know, some people drink, other things, but cats. Yeah. Cats bring in it, but they're meditative too. They're great to play with. I mean, they make you feel good, and they're just.
Oh, that's great! Oh, Jessica just calling me meow. That's lovely.
I've written several songs about cats. I've written one called Nine Lights years ago.
Oh wow! This totally is about songwriting. Then great question. Well, thank you, Paul, for that answer. And we have one more question.
If you want to visit Charlie and or Farley, you can visit anytime.
Oh, I'm sure. I'm sure we'd absolutely love to meet them. So our last question from video comes from RJ Chesney. And here's
better not be about cats.
Hi, Paul. You've interviewed an incredible amount of
artist in so many different genres of music. And I was wondering if there was a particular artist that you interviewed that you were not overly familiar with and got a greater appreciation for their music through your discovery by writing about them.
That's a nice question. Yeah, because there's been several. Because I can't really do a good job. I mean, I can, but it's hard if you don't have an authentic, genuine connection with the music, especially if you're interviewing them. I tend to listen to the music. And, you know, it was years ago, I was working for a musician magazine, and they said, have you heard of Michele Ndegeo Cello? And I hadn't. I was intrigued by that name. Mm-hmm. And it was right when she was starting out. And she's this amazing bass player. I mean, she's still this funky singer. She was on Madonna's label, and she just blew me away. She had an amazing band, but she was really, back then, this was like early, mid-80s, talking about racism constantly, the everyday racism that she was dealing with. And I remember she was on Arsenio Hall show. That was a very big, American TV show. And it was the last week of the show, so I wasn't allowed to say that I was a reporter. They gave me a fake name, Marco West. And I went to the show with her. And then we went out for dinner, and then we went and she did her laundry. And I always remember that her little son, Askia, was playing on the floor with his little dinosaurs. And a little white girl came over, and I heard the mother say, "We do not play with those boys," like that. And Michelle said, "Put that in your article, Paul, see?" And I did, you know, but
yeah, great.
She was just schooling me on that. But there were a lot of musicians, so I didn't know their stuff as well, and I got to know it.
And I guess you get inspired as a songwriter yourself, you know, being in contact with them and hearing about their process and then hearing their music, of course, to go back to that adage, we're all links in a chain. And so I would imagine being around these great songwriters so much.
Yeah, and it's important to honor those links. And, you know, even recently, as you mentioned, I interviewed Finneas and Billie Eilish, his sister. Mm-hmm. Finneas wrote and produced all of her songs.
Wow.
And he has his own album. They are serious musicians. So,
yeah,
you know, I wanted to, like, and I really liked a lot of Billy's music, but I was really moved by it. And I mean, amazing production that he does, but he's a real musician. And so is she, really a tremendous singer and brilliant, but they're all about melodies too, which makes me happy as an old school dude. You know, like I like a melody, and her first big song, Ocean Eyes, that he wrote, that's beautiful melody.
Yeah.
And so it gives me hope that melody can live on. And, yes. And if you've ever heard his song, Finneas, Let's Fall in Love for Tonight, it's like a Cole Porter song, but with 80s, but with you know, modern vernacular, it's as good as it gets. You know, I just love that.
Well, yeah, hope for the future of songwriting when people, because I think Finneas is like 23 or something. Isn't she like 17 or?
She's 18, and yeah, I think he's 24 now. But
wow, man, I mean, that's amazing. What a team.
He's a smart guy. He realized like a good song is what it's about. And that's really, not everyone gets to that point, but he said some of their songs, they would go out and just do them solo before they'd make the record. Mm-hmm. And he said all that production is just to try to reach that place that you could get to one voice and one song, you know, and one instrument. And that he knows that's more powerful. That says everything.
Yeah, and that's going to be a great article then. When it's coming out in American Songwriter, when can we expect it?
Any day now. The digital version showed up, so it's out any day now.
Well,
Billie actually didn't do any more interviews, but she was doing it because she loved her brother, and he loves her. They really love each other, too. That's really it comes down to they had great parents, too. Their mom, Maggie, they homeschooled them in a school of art. Good parenting. It really helps. Yeah.
And I know they encouraged them in the arts. A friend of mine actually was teaching Billie Shakespeare when she was a kid. So they
did that.
So I think the parents were very supportive of them going into the arts and obviously
recognize
their talents.
They're actors and musicians. Maggie taught them how to write songs, but they didn't want to force it on them. So they just had instruments everywhere. There's pianos, there's every kind of instrument, but they didn't force it. And Finneas took to it first, and then gradually Billy like, well, let me do this too.
Wow.
But
look at them now. I mean, that's just an extraordinary story. Yeah, it really is. Well, we look forward to reading the article. And Paul, you know, we're way over time, but they expected that of us. So if you don't mind, can you give us one more song before we finish up?
I'd love to. I tend to overstay my welcome often. I do that.
Oh, no, it's great. And then they're going to come back to me, and we got a few announcements to make, and we're going to play actually a video with a Harry Nilsson song. So do stick around for that, too. So. So, Paul, thank you so much for being with us. We look forward to seeing you again. And thank you for all the work that you do in the community and bringing all this great wisdom to us through your writings and your songs.
It's a pleasure getting to talk to you always. It's fun. I really do think we can at least once a week if we can.
It sounds good. I'll talk to you soon, brother. Thank you.
Thank you. Trying to tune here, too. It's a little warm here because I turned my air down. So I think that's why the guitar's doing this. Or just to mess with me. Well, I'm going to do a song now I wrote with Daryl Purpose, saying how I co-wrote, and I wrote a whole album of songs, Daryl's most recent album, called Still the Birds. Because he said at one point, maybe we should write all the songs together. And so I got really aggressive and started sending him lyrics. And I wrote the lyrics, and he wrote the music for this. I find you have to really tune these well, or it just doesn't quite sound good. Someone like Neil Rosengarten might be listening to my good friend who has perfect pitch and just might go, oh God, that's atrocious. Can you hear that? So anyway, this is called Sheena's Dog. And this is funny because Daryl Purpose, besides being a good songwriter, is one of the top 10 blackjack players, champion blackjack players in the world. He's so good, in fact, that he's banned from most casinos in the world. So he's pretty good with numbers. And I wrote the lyric, and I didn't mean it, but it starts out, it's midnight in New Orleans, but here it's only 9, talking about Los Angeles. And Daryl said, Paul, I can't sing that, because it would not be 9 here, it would be 10. And I said, no, that reflects, you know, the mind of the guy who's writing the song, that he doesn't know that. And he said, no, I'm going to be singing the song, I can't sing that. So he wanted me just to change it. It was midnight in New Orleans now. The sun's going down over Santa Monica and Vine. Just change that to just Santa Monica. But if you live in Los Angeles, there's a big difference between Santa Monica and Santa Monica and Vine, right? And that's in Hollywood. So when I sing it the way it should be. So this is called Sheena's Dog. Got some adult chords. Midnight in New Orleans now, but here it's only 9. I've been watching the sun go down over Santa Monica and Vine. I still got all the letters that we wrote back in 1975. I would drive my car Sheena's house if I had a car to drive. And if she were still alive, and the moon's behind a billboard now, and the streets full of fog, time is just a bone we're set. Oh, that we said for Sheena's doll, Sheena's doll. Sheena had a Pinto then, was the best car she could afford. She used to keep it in her daddy's barn when the grapes ripe for store. 7 sheepdogs and a chicken coop, they spilled out fields of corn. 7 weeks went by, the sun came up, and Sheena's dog was born. Sheena's dog was born. And the moon's behind the stars tonight, and the streets are full of fog. Time is just a bone we sell, a bone we sell. Sheena's dog, Sheena's dog, Sheena's dog's big and gentle, with ears that flop from side to side. I think I've grown maybe more sentimental ever since that old dog died. She was making movies then, and I got to be her movie star. I was singing Woody Guthrie's song on Geronimo's guitar. We used to harmonize a Beatles song in my little Hollywood backyard. And we'd walk all the way to Echo Park along Sunset Boulevard. All along Sunset Boulevard. Yeah, yeah. Moon's behind your eyes tonight, but these streets are full of fog. Time is just a bone we save, bone we save, yeah. Time is just a bone we save. Time is just a bone we save. Oh, we say, for she is down, she is down, she is down, she is down. Yeah, thank you.
And that was Paul Zolo, a fine musician and writer, and what a wonderful guest. We appreciate him spending so much time with us tonight. And if you want more Paul Zolo, which I'm sure you do, be sure to go online and check out his books, his music, his photos, his many articles in American Songwriter and other publications. There's just so much to choose from. I'm telling you, this one guy has produced enough material to get us through multiple quarantines. So whatever happens from here on in, Paul's got us covered. Thank you, Paul. That was just awesome. I should mention tips one last time. Help support our musical guest and everybody involved in the show. So if you'd like to throw something in the tip jar, that would be fantastic. We would really appreciate it. PayPal.me/DivineRebelMusic and Venmo.com/DivineRebelMusic. So feel free to throw something in there. And if you can't, that's absolutely fine. We appreciate having you with us. Upcoming shows, Sunday, July 12th, which is this coming Sunday at 5 p.m. is the second Sunday Songwriter Series. Now, it's a virtual open mic. So if you would like to submit something for it, that would be fantastic. We'd love to see a video of you doing a song. It can be an original or it can be a cover. Whatever, it's a virtual open mic and we play videos, and we've had some fine musicians submit songs for this, and it's just been, this will be, I think, the third or fourth time that we're actually doing this one virtually. It used to be a live show, but obviously because of the current situation, we're doing it this way, and it's always worked out fantastic. And our feature artists are Jacob Monday and also Lucy Clearwater, and that's really going to be a great show. So if you want to submit to the open mic, go to DivineRebelMusic.com/open mic instructions. You'll see it right there. Then the following day, which is a week from tonight, that's Monday, July 13th at 7 p.m., it's another episode of Songs and Sit-Downs. That's featuring Gwendolyn Oliver, who's a very interesting person who was high up in corporate America, decided she wanted to become an actress, moved to Hollywood, and had a challenge in the form of a brain tumor. And I'm going to let you tell her all about her experiences, but a very interesting person to talk to. So it's going to be a great interview. And then following Gwendolyn, we're going to have Unsung Lily, great duo, two women, I believe, originally from England, living in America now. And what a wonderful pair of singers and songwriters. It's really going to be a great show. So we hope to see you back Monday, 7 p.m. And we do promise not to go past 9 o'clock in that show. We'll try to keep it to the scheduled hour if we can. Monday, July 20th, which is the following week, 2 weeks from tonight, Songs and Sit-Downs, we're back with Adam Gaynor, who's one of the founding members of Matchbox 20, the band, arguably, of the 90s. And he's a really interesting guy, doing a lot of stuff musically, but also in other areas, creative areas. And so it'll be great to catch up with him. And we also have the Rose Valley Thorns. Now, if you have not seen the Rose Valley Thorns, you have to see this band. They're from Ojai, California, and wow, what a great bluegrass band. Really top-notch. So do come back and join us for that. So we got some great guests coming up. And, you know, we want to thank everybody who was involved in this show, who made this all possible. Thank you, Dolly and JJ, of course, and Jessica, and all of the people who submitted questions for Paul. That was Jimmy, of course, RJ, Noe, who was plugging his Photoshop, and why the hell not? Jessica, who asked that great question about the cats, Laura, Michael, and of course, a big thank you to our very special guests, Josefina Lopez and Paul Zolo. I have to do that, Josefina, because she taught me how to pronounce her name, if you remember, way back to about an hour and 40 minutes ago. I'm always afraid I'm going to say it wrong. So Josefina and Paul, thank you for being our special guests tonight. We're so grateful for the time that you spent with us. And of course, a big thank you to you, our audience, for tuning in. We really appreciate your joining us this evening. Now, we're going to leave you with, as we usually do, a video of the week. This one is a song called He Needs Me, and it's featured in the movie Popeye, starring Robin Williams and Shelley Duvall. The song was written by Harry Nilsson, and who better to interpret this song than Alessandra Neiswanger, who actually has, in fact, recently recorded an entire album of Harry Nilsson songs. It's called Neiswanger Sings Nilsson, and you should check it up. Check it out. It's really very, very excellent. Thanks so much for being with us tonight. We look forward to seeing you again next Monday with another edition of Songs and Sit-Downs. And till then, stay safe and be kind. This is Alessandra Neiswanger with He Needs Me.
And 2, 3, 4. I knew at once, I knew he needed me. Until the day I die, I won't know why, I knew he needed me. It could be fantasy, oh. Maybe it's because he needs me, he needs me, he needs me, he needs me, he needs me. He needs me, he needs me, he needs me, he needs me, he needs me. Like a diamond dance, I'll take a chance, I will, because he needs me. Mm-hmm. No one ever asked before, because they never needed me. Maybe it's because he's so alone. Maybe it's because he never had a home. He needs me, he needs me, he needs me, he needs me, he needs me. He needs me, he needs me, he needs me, he needs me. Da 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 da
me